Okay. My government name is Lee Howard Daffin. I was born in St. Louis, Missouri. Mm-hmm. And I left St. Louis. Actually, I joined the military in a split option program during my junior year of high school. Then I went on to active duty after I graduated, always knowing that I had higher aspirations, but I needed to get out of the ghetto.
Mm-hmm.
So my Hebrew name is Eliyyah Ben Israel. And I've actually what's funny is this has been one long journey of never-ending learning. Mm-hmm. You know, I looked into the Nation of Islam. I looked into all types of different things. My father was a Pentecostal pastor. I think we discussed this before. Mm-hmm. I had asked him many questions that I really didn't get concrete answers to. Once I started working for the government, I started seeing different levels of operation of things that were happening above my level.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, being inquisitive, I mean, even if we went back into slave times where the servants would be serving the masters around the tables, they would be speaking of us and their plans as if we weren't even there, because they knew that we had a certain mindset that we dare not or didn't have the power to change whatever it is their plans were. I just didn't realize that thing had actually was expeditionally pushed into the time that we're in now. Mm-hmm. So with that, I went the route of trying to be a Boy Scout, a patriot, you know, Martin Luther King, you know, the peace movement, you know, studied Marcus Garvey. I'd read several books about the Panthers. And, you know, I always wondered, I looked at Malcolm X, and even as he started coming out and started having a different understanding from what he had learned in the Nation of Islam. Mm-hmm. And then there's also another brother, right, that was recently murdered. He started understanding that we are the children of Israel, regardless of him having respect for Elijah Muhammad or whatever. When you actually start getting into the details of history and the ones that the history is still there, mm-hmm, but they don't show you.
Right.
Then you start begin to line up some of the things that's actually in the same scriptures that we carry around every day, but we just can't see what they are. So I said that to say this. I'm a former police officer. I'm a former mercenary. I was in Iraq in 2007 to 2009. You know, I was part of specialized units, whether I was attached to a Marine unit or Navy SEALs or an Army MP unit. We had specific missions to go in and do certain things. And I would watch CNN and couldn't understand why what I was watching on CNN was the exact opposite of what was taking place. So actually when I was in Iraq, believe it or not, put mm-hmm. my foot into Euphrates. You know, I'm in the desert and I took time to fast because I felt a special connection to this land, and I couldn't understand why. So there was if I were to fast forward it, when I start actually looking scripturally from Abraham on and so on, and you know, we were in what is modern day Iraq or Syria and all those other lands and in Africa and the places that we left in 70 AD to go down into, you know, that part came later. But before I even understood that part, I understood that the people that literally run the world today, even scripturally. But before I knew it was scriptural, the people that run the world today have a global governance mindset, and it lines up absolutely. And we have never wanted retribution as a people. We only wanted to fit in, and we've tried everything from, you know, being governors and running for office and all these other things, but yet we still see, as a matter of fact, we're seeing an uptick with the current president, and it doesn't matter whether it was Obama, Clinton, or anybody else. If you go back like I did, because again, remember, I'm cut from a different cloth. Right. I do research. So I actually look at the policies and a lot of things that were instituted by whether it be Reagan, Obama, or anybody else. And you have to understand how that affects us as a community.
Right.
And we continue to march and, you know, no justice, no peace. But as soon as Thanksgiving come around, you know, we stop marching. Mm-hmm. You know, you look at France and what's going on now, you know, they're in their 12th week of, you know, we ain't going to have this no more of the bankers doing what they're doing. Mm-hmm. But even I have a greater understanding of even what that's about. Mm-hmm. Because it's part of the global plan to do what it is they're going to do. Mm-hmm. I have no fear about what's happening, but I do realize that we're at this 400-year mark. And a lot of people, especially, you know, I hear a lot of our Muslim brothers talk about, well, we've been in slavery more than 400 years and so on and so forth. So that can't be true. And I think about when I go back to the actual scriptures themselves, Yah always dealt with nations of people. And when he spoke of specific nations, that's where the pinnacle was. I don't care if it was the Persian Empire, a Babylonian Empire, it was the onset. See, even though the Babylonian or Persian Empire spread to across a vast land,
right,
everything still came back to where it was like instituted and sanctioned. Mm-hmm. Just like you know, the United States is talking about, you know, recognizing 400 years of us being here in America, but they phrase it as if our contributions to mm-hmm. America, you know, they don't look at it as enslavement, or, you know, they want to look at all the things that we contributed, and they don't even give us half the credit for that. How many inventors, whether it be the stoplight or the computer or anything else, that we actually get credit for? Mm-hmm. So the thing is that when you realize that, you know, in scripture, when it tells us that we'll be last, but, you know, during this time frame of our punishment, that other nations will come in and rise high above us. You and I, we spoke about that. You know, mm-hmm. I don't care what hood you go into, you can go anywhere in the United States. You've got Asians, you've got Arabs, you've got everybody else running these businesses and communities. And, you know, we may get a little piece of the pie, but for the most part, we won't even really support one another. And what I see is, we may not have a full understanding of how this is going to take place, mm-hmm. but I believe that biblically and scripturally, even those things that we don't get now, that awakening that's starting to call us back mm-hmm. to a place, because, you know, scripture says that he'll actually pull us back from these different locations. Mm-hmm. But I think there's like an advanced party, and I honestly feel that I'm part of that advanced party, because it's been in my spirit long before I knew I was a Hebrew Israelite. It was in my spirit. I worked for the government. I've been a good house nigga, you mm-hmm. know, and I'm sorry to say it that way, but, uh-huh. but, you know, everything they asked me to do, I did. And I tried to do tenfold better than the people, tasked with the same mission, and only to still be looked at as a nigga. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I hate to use those terms, but that's the terms that they call us by. You know, the scripture said that we will be known by bywords. And there's no other nation that I know of that every 10 years, you know, their nationality gets changed. You know, mm-hmm. We go from Negro to coon to, you know, nigger to, I mean, African-American, black. I mean, every time that we even begin to start trying to research or become aware of who we are as a people,
right,
they've already figured out a way to then take that away and then restart the process, whether it be hip hop or anything else. Every time we start to try to build ourselves, I don't care whether it's Rosewood, I don't care whether it's Black Wall Street, you know, we didn't have pants sagging in Black Wall Street. No. It's just that it was not time. This is biblical. Mm-hmm. It's biblical. It said that no man would deliver us from this. And so the persecution that we see that's happening around the world, whether it be in Africa, whether it be in Haiti, the things that we're seeing that are starting to transpire. Am I talking too much? Because you need to get in. Because I'll let you in.
No. Don't take anything from my appearance. I'm just sort of, you know, breathing. That's all. Don't mind me. You know, I'm listening to every word you're saying. This is great.
Okay.
I'm just okay, sitting here, you know, trying to look, you know, good for the camera while you talk. That's all. You know, by all means, you know, this is exactly, you know, what I was hoping for. You know, somebody who has a, you know, deep insight about the larger, you know, implications of how our people are living every day.
The great large implications is that it's no different than Pharaoh. You know, they've been trying to get rid of us. If you look at the statistics, mm-hmm. they're not reproducing themselves.
Yes.
they actually think that this is something of their own fruition. But the plagues that happened in Egypt is getting ready to happen to them. Mm-hmm. And we've already seen it happen throughout the world. The same thing when they had no sympathy for us during the crack epidemic, even though they're the ones that brought it in, the CIA did. I have well documented proof of that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we don't have AK-47s and things like that. Have these people out of Chicago never left Chicago, mm-hmm. so or in South Central LA or any of these other places. I was a police officer at the time, mm-hmm. so I was aware that it's impossible for them to get a hold of these weapons when I am a law enforcement officer and I'm trying to buy an AK and I've got to go through all these federal checks in order to get one. Mm-hmm. So this thing has never changed from COINTELPRO to MK Ultra to all the other stuff. You know, they want to coin you a conspiracy theorist mm-hmm. the moment you actually see their own white papers. Mm-hmm. This isn't something that is not new. Yeah. You know, whether it be Aleister Crowley, Albert Pike, mm-hmm. Adam Weishaupt, mm-hmm. the Bavarian Illuminati who came here and got into the Freemasonry, mm-hmm. Whether it be the Jesuit order, whether it be the Zionist Jews, which are all the same thing, mm-hmm. the Revelation 2:9 and 3:9, as far as I see it. You know, those that call themselves Jews that are not, but a synagogue of Satan. But yet, for us, mm-hmm. the true seed, we envelop every bit of the Deuteronomy curses and all of the things that it talks about in our redemption mm-hmm. and him and us rising back to the top, meaning, you know, Esau being the end and Jacob being the beginning.
Right.
All of these things are actually starting to manifest. But if you have no concept, mm-hmm. I'll give you a prime example.
Please.
I am so versed in, and I think the Most High that he gave me an opportunity to be an independent thinker. Because remember, I started off in law enforcement, so evidence meant a lot to me.
Right.
As far as being able to put together. Usually you follow the money and that usually brings you back to your bad guy who you're looking for. Mm-hmm. But when I started looking deeper,
right,
everything into what you would consider, even what they're going to do now, 5G network, the connection of all things, frequency. You start looking at different aspects of them being able to create something like CERN. Mm-hmm. Before we knew about CERN, it was already built and underground. And it's way more places that these things operate, even some in Texas. Mm-hmm. And so when I started realizing that the majority of people, everybody from that created the atom bomb, mm-hmm. or even Scientology, the Hubert or whatever his name is that was part of Scientology, he was one of Aleister Crowley's proteges. Mm-hmm. And if you don't know who Aleister Crowley is, I'm telling you, this dude was like the most evil, satanic, before you ever even heard of, you know, some of these other satanic guys that had so-called satanic church, right. That you saw, you know, Sammy Davis Jr. And a lot of these other people. I guess what I'm trying to explain is, without getting too deep into all of that, is we live in a world in which the veil has been pulled over our eyes, but it was only there for a while. Mm-hmm. And now we're starting to see an awakening of the true people of the Most High. Mm-hmm. And they're feeling in their spirit, but they don't quite understand why they're awakening or why their feelings. It's not just being tired of colonialism. There is a spirit of evil. There is a spirit of antichrist, so mm-hmm. to speak, that is entering into this world. So, you know, some people will look at it and go, oh, well, I'm just tired of racism and I want to go back to Africa. Mm-hmm. Some people in Africa are going, you know what, you know, they are raping us of our resources and they've come here and we need to send them back. And there's all kinds of different things happening. Mm-hmm. But for those that are scripturally I'm not talking about the Christians with T.D. Jakes and all the people that came through the seminaries. I'm talking about the brothers that are starting to wake up through the spirit and can see this thing in scripture. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That, of course, we're not all going to be on one accord at this moment, but his spirit is going to bring us back together because we are a part of that nation of people that in Psalms 83 that said that the whole world conspired to make us a name no more. And now the sins of them have reached to the high heavens, just like in Sodom and Gomorrah, and our punishment is over.
I see.
At the end of this 400 years, we're already starting to see it happen. See, it's just like what happened in Egypt. Did it happen all at one time, or did he start pouring out those vials and those plagues, you know, slowly? And then at the same time that these same plagues, and don't think that I don't know they have weather weapons. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember I work for the government. I'm well aware they have weather weapons. I would harp and get, you know, cloud cleaning, what do you call it, cloud seeding. All that stuff happened before. And now they're doing something on a greater level with chemtrailing and things like that are starting to happen. Mm-hmm. But the thing is what happens is that we start losing focus when we don't understand what the end game is. Mm-hmm. We start looking at these things as if we can change it through government or marching. These people have never, and I don't hate white people. I don't hate any other name. But I do recognize our enemy. Mm-hmm. And we have always been a people that if you come over to our side, mm-hmm. you know, we embrace you. We embrace you fully. You know, as long as you come in the right heart, we embrace you fully. But the thing is that there's a lot of people out here that are, I think they're government agents, actually. Because right. It's been no different, whether it was through any other movement that we had, where they try to make this awakening look bad mm-hmm. by having, you know, angry young black men on the corner screaming out they want to kill all white people. That is not the premise that I come from. Mm-hmm. My understanding is that I personally have and understanding that Yah is calling us back into, because there's the scripture, and I wish I would pull it up for you so I could give you that exact scripture. Mm-hmm. Because it says that he was going to return us back unto the place we were carried away from. See, so when we start talking about going back into the wilderness, mm-hmm. we are literally talking about if we came out of Nigeria and Ghana and those were supposed to be the gates of no return, he's going to return us there first. So we are in the wilderness of the people. Mm-hmm. So while he's raining down whatever he's doing for this new world order and, you know, punishing these people for what they've done, and as our light shine, they will be attracted to us.
Okay.
And so he's going to wind up dealing with all the rebels, even among Israel. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that is when his spirit is poured out and we start coming back together, those that have been pushed into Islam, those that have been pushed into Hinduism, whatever it is, if you're an Israelite, you're going to be purged based off of that spirit that's being poured out, because we're always going to have no different in Egypt. You know, when they were in the wilderness, you had Korah and company. You know, they want to circumvent what Abraham was doing. And Yah said, I'm going to kill them a new way. Everybody step back, get away from them. And the earth opened up and swallowed them up. So there's nothing different. Everything that we see that's happened before, we see happening again. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I love my people, and I'm not willing to throw my people away because we have a difference of opinion. But the one thing that I do see in happening is spiritual. Mm-hmm. I know that it's biblical, but just because, you know, you're hearing a voice inside is telling you to return to the land, mm-hmm. you just haven't gotten the rest of it. And I promise, you know, there's a reason that this is happening. You know, there's only two times that the Europeans have gone in Africa, because it was called Canaan before that. Mm-hmm. So it had many names before they went in the first time. When they decided to go in and carve it up, and the French and all these people went in and they carved up Africa, and then they gave it different names, and then they appointed kings and leaders. But yet we still have Bafaria. We still have the Igbo. We still have other people that have maintained some semblance. And that's even in scripture. Mm-hmm. That the northern tribe that remained in Africa would still have some semblance of who they were. They still did circumcision. They still, on the eighth day, named their children. They still did certain things. And then now that this information is starting to come out, now our enemy is now going in, because they still don't have a full understanding of what's going on, and now trying to give them legitimacy under Judaism. No, they are converts. These mm-hmm. people are from Khazaria. These are Turkish. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine the same time that the fake Israel was created? Because if you read scripture, mm-hmm. it said that once they were brought back into the land, they would be living in unwalled cities in peace. Mm-hmm. I don't see no unwalled cities in peace. Mm-hmm. But Saudi Arabia was created at the same time. Right. They're of the same family. Mm-hmm. And if I just looked at a recent thing where Saudi Arabia now wants to get nuclear weapons, and Israel is in agreement with it and is going to supply them with this information. Let me tell you something. Mosai said that I ain't mad that they going in Africa the second time, because mm-hmm. I have a different understanding as to why.
Right.
See, they've raped Africa, but at the same time, Africans, not the leadership, but the people mm-hmm. are starting to wake up. Mm-hmm. And so as they build the infrastructure for us, mm-hmm. when Yah calls us back, after he finished whooping them and throwing all these plagues on them, and we start returning to the land, some on our own and some at a later date, right. what's going to happen is they will have already built the infrastructure for us. Mm-hmm. And they will be kicked out, because he said he's going to call them down to the Valley of Jehoshaphat to plead with them for us. Now, pleading don't mean begging. Mm-hmm. But for those that are still on the outskirts, according to scripture, mm-hmm. they will still exist for those that don't kill, or those that don't die. Mm-hmm. But when Yeshua actually does return, I ain't talking about their fake thing that they're doing. I'm talking when Yeshua actually returns, we are supposed to be the kings and queens, or should I say the ruler? We are the 12 tribes that will teach them how to live righteously. They'll still have to come in. They won't come into the city. It says that the scripture actually says that there will still be sorcerers and dogs outside of the city.
Right.
So you always want to be on the inside.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that people look at scripture from a different standpoint because they haven't, if Yah's spirit hasn't awakened them yet,
mm-hmm.
the only thing that I can say is when you do decide to read the scriptures, ask that he remove the scales from your eyes and you start realizing it's your history book. And yes, it has been tampered with to some degree. But right. This is what I will say.
Mm-hmm.
Yah was so smart that when he said precept upon precept, line upon line, he was going to be able to give you what you needed that they could not take away. It's like an equation and a code that's in your DNA that you're going to get that they can't get.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And every religion that I know on the face of the earth always has to go back and quote the Bible or quote scripture. And many of us, especially with the Pan-African movement and all this other stuff, say to themselves, it's the white man's book. No, it was our book, and they took it and they made sure that they wanted to try to manipulate certain aspects, but they knew they couldn't change too much. So mm-hmm. that's kind of my gist on what I believe as far as, you know, because it's like, again, that's not right. going to stop me from working with my brothers or loving my brothers. You don't have to agree with me, but you're going to mm-hmm. see it happen right before your eyes because we're seeing it every day. Absolutely seeing it every day.
Mm-hmm. No, I think you're right, Eliyah. Let me ask you something. Now that you have come to these understandings, have you made any plans to move to an African country, or is that something that's in the distant future for you, or what? Or have you already made a transition?
No. I can't say it's a distant future thing. As a matter of fact, one of the reasons I'm in London right now mm-hmm. is that I married a woman that I believe is in full agreement
mm-hmm.
with the plans of where I think the Most High has taken us. She owns a property here in London that we're trying to sell.
Mm-hmm.
And we're in the process of doing that. I still own 6 acres back where I'm from. My son is home taking care of that.
Mm-hmm.
And I really feel like I need to be home because here in London, I'm like powerless. I don't have the ability to do anything. So, what I'm doing at the moment is trying to help her through her process of getting this taken care of. Once we get back there, I own my property full out. I don't pay any rent. Mm-hmm. So we'll be able to take those funds, go back, create a web-based business or a business that will sustain itself to some degree. We're right. going to – we actually wanted to go back during the July, August return mm-hmm. Celebration that was happening, that's happening in Ghana right now.
Right.
We wanted to go there because we understood that there was supposed to be some information about fast-tracking our ability to get dual citizenship.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I've been in contact with a few people regarding that. But for me, financially, a lot of that's dependent on whether this sells – within that time frame, whether I get back in time to take care of some other issues. I've got one of my brothers is actually friends with a prince in Ghana.
Uh-huh.
And so, you know, yeah, he's made it clear to me when you're ready to go, he's out of the country. He says when he gets back in the country, you know, let me know when you want to meet with him. And so I wound up going to his palace or wherever he is, and we'll get a chance to chop it up just like I'm chopping it up with you.
Mm-hmm.
And because ultimately what I really would like to do once I get there, once we've got because see, we already know, let's be clear about this. The fiat currency and the Rothschild banking system, and we know all that's getting ready to crash. We know that it's run its course, but it's been it was done on purpose in order to bring in a one world currency. They've already tried the North American Union, but too many people were awake to it, so it didn't happen right away. They did do the European Union. The reason why you have AFRICOM over in Africa right now is because they still want to create an African Union. You have Israel wanting to be part of the African the African Congress. So I mean, I have definitely done my research, and I am aware of the things that are occurring around the world, but it's still all going back to what Albert Pike and all of the white papers talk about. Agenda 21, which is now Agenda 2030. A lot of the technologies that they've rolled out slowly, it's basically the frog in the boiling pot. What happens is they already know what they have planned, including a lot of genocide and so on and so forth. But instead of doing it just so overtly, they've done it through vaccines, the food, through the Wi-Fi networks, and they're doing it through chemtrailing now. There's a lot of stuff that's going on that has a lot more, because even the chemtrails have multiple purposes. You know, it's raining down. It's changing the pH soil. It's changing the pH in the soil to where the only thing that can grow will be Monsanto seeds, and now owned by Bayer. Is there a coincidence that Obama actually signed something called the Monsanto Protection Act? It's because other nations start figuring out what was going on. And so that meant that they couldn't be sued by in the international court by other people. See, most people don't pay attention to these things.
Right.
I've been well up on it through the grace of the Most High that's put these things in my path. So my thing is that if I can get back to Ghana, or I can get back to a place, and Ghana is what's been really sticking in my craw. But I'd love to be able to open up a hotel or a B&B or whatever, and maybe open up some type of travel agency, make connections with some type of airline, even if it's an African airline, or if need be, if I had to create my own. The thing is I would look. If we don't think big, it'll never happen.
But the thing is that
for those that as these persecutions continue to happen to our people, and as they start realizing that the same Jesus that they've been believing in, and what I mean by that is not Yeshua. We still have God,
right?
You know, Elohim, you know, and we still have Yeshua, our sacrifice, Yah made flesh. We still have all that. But what happened was, is that Caesar Borgia, when, you know, it speaks in scripture where it says they will paint the likenesses of themselves. There was already warnings of what was going to take place. And unfortunately, what we see taking place is that they've done such a good job of that, is that that's what allowed slavery, our mental disconnect, and what's the other word I'm looking for? Stockholm Syndrome.
Right.
These are the things that don't allow us to understand our true power. We were the ones, the Moors that ran Europe and all those other things. A lot of these Moors, some of them were Muslim, a lot of them were Israelites. But the thing was, is that because we still keep disobeying what he gave us to rule the world,
right,
then he took away from us.
Mm-hmm.
And he gave us into the hands of the worst of the heathen. And now he even said in scripture that he would destroy them for not only what he did to his people, because he expected us to go into captivity. He just didn't expect them to, or should I say, they took it too far, according to what he had desired. Because even when we had to deal with people, we still dealt with them as our brother, even if they were slaves of ours. And then at the end of a certain period of time, at 7 years, you know, we forgave their debts. We sent them away with money, all this other stuff. The Jewish people then created something totally different, the Kabbalah and the Talmud and all this other. Look, they have no Shemitic blood whatsoever in their body. But now, through information and through technology, and the two witnesses haven't even shown up yet. So I'm telling you, there are things that are occurring and that will continue to occur, but it requires each man to search his own heart to be in the place where Yah can use them for his benefit, because we're still one people, we're still one nation. And the whole purpose for us was to be able to bless the other nations, for those that could see that light. This is not a hateful thing. This is not against white people. This is not against Asian. This is not against any of them. But these people in Psalms 83, they came together, because anytime we ever went into captivity before, we knew who we were. So all we did was call out and repented. And Yah destroyed our enemies and brought us back into power. They say, oh, no, we got it this time. We know what to do this time.
Right. So let me ask you something. A lot of what you've said makes a hell of a lot of sense. And off the record, I'm going to probably use a lot of your comments in between interviews so far, because you really have a lot of insightful commentaries to make. So you were thinking that when you moved back to, say, Ghana for for your purposes, you would like to, you know, start a business in like housing or some type of B2B. Are there any advice you would give a potential expate about the kind of pitfalls they might be wary of prior to moving to any African country, whether it be Ghana or Nigeria or someplace else?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. There's quite a few.
Please.
The reason why, okay, first of all, on YouTube, there's a lot of people that's already moved there that can give you information into some of the mistakes that they made. We've got organizations already there, expats and of Americans that are there that have tried to weed through some of that. It's no different than place else, in the sense that whenever you are a foreigner coming in, there will always be people that will try to take advantage and think that you're rich. You know, and you're coming over there and you really are taking everything that you own to try to reestablish yourself. And they will assume that you're this, because they look at Jay-Z and Beyonce and all this other stuff, and they think that you're coming over there with endless pockets. And so the thing that you have to do is still utilize common sense. You have to act like you're at a flea market. You're trying to bottom dollar, but you also want to connect with people that already have been through it. And that was one of the things that when I get there, I've already been given a few contacts, and I need to vet them for myself. You got to remember, I told you I was a police officer, and I was, you know, former government and things like that. So what I want to do is see, okay, are you really connected to the government? Or, you know, what organizations are you, you know, what is your track record? What are you doing? What real estate agents can we trust? Because there's a lot of land issues where people are selling land that doesn't belong to them. And so what we want to do is we want to stream, at least what I want to do when I get there is I want to streamline, because I'm sure that there's other people that's doing it. But I just want to be somebody else that's doing it, because I'm going into it from a detective standpoint. I'm going into it. I know spiritually why I'm going, but I don't want anybody to come there and be taken advantage of. I don't want people to spend, $800 for 3 weeks to just go and find the landscape and not, you know what I'm saying? You show up at a B&B and yet, there's nothing there. There's no conferences. There's no, like when you wake up in the morning, I would love to be able to say, okay, let's look at why you're here and what you're here to do.
Right.
Okay. If you're here for fun and sun, okay, I can point you in this direction.
Right.
If you're here to try to understand the landscape because you want to move here, then these are the reputable companies. These are the reputable people that I have vetted myself. I've gone through, I understand, the legalities of this and, this I can set you up with these people, or these are the numbers of these people and this is what you do. They'll go and show you land. They'll do this and they'll do that, but you don't have to worry about when you buy that land, somebody's going to come back and say it belongs to their great, great grandfather. So these are, different aspects of what I pray the Most High is actually using me for, to help our people start coming back, because it's going to get only worse where we are in the States. Once they close those borders, that wall isn't to keep them out. That wall is to keep people in. And most people don't understand that. And, when you understand the agenda, and I'm talking about the white papers, and it's many organizations, people think that, and what's funny is that, I hear people that know a little bit about it, and they'll say, oh, it's the Freemasons. And then other people say, oh, it's the Bilderbergs. And, oh, it's Skull and Bones. Oh, it's the Committee of 300. Oh, it's, the Rothschilds and the Rockefellers and the Fords. And what you don't realize is that that tree has many branches, same root.
Yes.
And so you're either attached to that tree of life, or this is why Yeshua tells us to come out of her. In Revelations, it tells us to come out of her. You don't realize that it is spiritually and figuratively. If you were, you have been conditioned all of your life to envelop a ideology of the Roman, Greco-Roman, Babylonian Empire. And survive inside of that when that was never part of who we were. And Yah allowed it to happen because, remember, he's the one that said he put the scales over our eyes. He said that when we went into this captivity, that we will be serving the gods of wood and stone. And I told you what those two were.
Yes.
But at the end of our punishment, he said that he would start lifting the veil from our eyes, because he was only angry with us for a little while. But then he would then turn those same plagues onto our enemy. Now, does that mean that every white person, every Asian, every... No, it doesn't. But there are many people that are so comfortable after seeing us shot down in the street. They put Michael Vick in jail over his cousins fighting dogs. We can look at examples of them, of people of non-color, non-melanated color, rape five-year-old children and get probation. You can look at people that punch police dog that was, or kicking a police dog that was biting them while they were handcuffed, and wind up getting 10 years for assault on a police officer, because they consider the dog a police officer. Look, I have lived through this. I've seen it over and over and over again. And I could not understand it until I realized that the way that our Christian pastors, the way that our people have been taught by our enemy to discern this scripture, it was never meant for us to understand it until this time. And mm-hmm. now when you stop back, I told you, you don't have to let anybody teach you anything. Read it for yourself with the blinders off, and you're going to see something different.
I hear you. Well, that's, believe me, you've given me a lot to think about, brother. And I want to try and do this again if you have some time so that we can, continue.
I have always. Yes, sir.
Well, thank you very much. And believe me, I look forward to speaking to you again so that, we can pass along your wisdom to other viewers and listeners, not only in the first film, but in all the successive ones as well. Thank you very much for your time and your insight, sir. This is Muhammadbey. The Exodus Film Project is a series of discussions with African and African-American movers and shakers on how African-Americans can move to African countries to live peaceful, successful lives. Please support the Exodus Film Project now by contributing to our campaign at GoFundMe. Future films will address other aspects of life in African countries, such as how others are making the transitions, stories from people who've already made the transitions to life in African countries, healthcare, food, real estate, money, travel, starting a business, making contacts, retirement, the realities of residency and citizenship, and much more. Thanks for watching. Take care.